Hello, welcome to NPTEL NOC, an introductory course on point set topology, part 2, module 41, dimension of subspaces and unions today. Okay, take a subspace of X, say X prime. Let us have this notation, boundary daba, I read it daba, boundary prime, okay, inside, boundary inside X prime, okay, denote the boundary of a subset with respect to X and X prime respectively. Then for any A inside X, we have the boundary of A intersection X prime taken inside X prime, that is a subset of boundary of A. Without any decoration, this boundary just denotes the boundary inside the larger space X. So, this is an elementary result which you have seen in the first part itself, but now it becomes very crucial. So, let us go through it a little carefully. Take a point which is the boundary of A intersection X prime in the subspace X prime. We start with that. Take an open set U, okay, of X now, such that X is inside U. We know that U intersection X prime is a neighborhood of X in X prime, and hence U intersection X prime intersects both A intersection X prime and its complement inside X prime, right? Because it is the boundary point of A intersection X prime. Therefore, this U intersection A, which is the union of U intersection X prime and A intersection X prime, this has to be non-empty. Okay. So, we have proved that starting with any open neighborhood of X, U intersection A is non-empty. What else we have to prove? We have to prove that its complement also intersects U, then it would be a boundary point of A intersection X prime, A itself inside X, right? So, what is the intersection of U with X minus A? That contains U intersection X prime as well as complement of A inside X prime. Okay, so after all, it's X minus A. Okay, so those which are X prime, inside X prime, those which are not inside X prime, I have taken entire U intersection X prime. But the first part is U intersection X prime. The second part is X prime minus A intersection X prime. Okay. So, one of them has to be non-empty as we have seen. Therefore, it follows that X must be inside boundary of A. Okay. So, one way is true. In fact, equality hardly occurs unless A itself is a closed subset of A intersection X prime is a closed subset of X1, or X prime itself is closed and so on. So, all that we need is one way inclusion here. So, we will use this one heavily now. Every subspace of a space of dimension less than or equal to n is of dimension less than or equal to n. Okay, when you take subspaces, dimension does not increase. So, this is the theorem here now. Okay, so start with a base for X such that dimension of the boundary of each member is less than or equal to n minus 1. So that is the definition of dimension being less than or equal to n. Then we know that if you take B prime, namely B intersection X prime as B ways over B, okay, that family is a base for X prime because subspace topology. By the lemma, we have boundary of B intersection X prime inside x prime is contained inside boundary of B. Okay. Now we induct on n. If n is 0, this implies the boundary of B is empty, therefore for each B inside B, therefore this is also empty. So this proves a statement of the theorem for n equal to 0. Inductively assume that we have proved a statement for n minus 1. Now this implies boundary, the dimension of boundary of B intersection X prime is less than equal to n minus 1 because it is subspace of the corresponding thing here. Hence the dimension of X prime is less than equal to n. So all the time we are using this one. Okay. If the dimension is say 5 here, that will be dimension will be less than equal to 5. Once we have proved that, for 6 dimensions this will prove, and so on. Okay, starting with 0, you can build up the induction. Alright. Okay, next theorem is let X be a subspace of a separable metric space, any space for that matter. Okay. A separable metric space you start with. Then X has dimension less than or equal to n if and only if given any closed subspace C of X and a point P inside P, not inside C, outside C, there is a closed subset D of X such that dimension of D is less than or equal to n minus 1 and X minus D is A disjoint union B with P inside A and C inside B. Remember what is S2. S2 said that points can be separated, a closed set and a point can be separated by Clopen sets. Clopen sets were those which such that dimension of the boundary itself is empty. Now here we have something else. This is an extended S2. It is n minus n dimensional version of S2. Okay. So dimension of X less than equal to n, you can't expect closed sets and a point outside it could be separated by Clopen sets. Clopen sets means boundary is empty. Now on that boundary we are going to put condition. So this is elaborately stated in a different way here. You throw away a closed subset D of dimension n minus 1. Then you have a separation. Okay. When you have a Clopen set, the boundary played that role. That's why we didn't have to bother about this way stating. Now here we throw away some closed subset. Of course, away from C and P. P and C you have to retain. Okay. So, X minus D is A union B. Okay. A and B are both closed and both open inside X minus D, and P is inside A and C is inside B, or the other way around. So, this is the generalized version of S2 now, you see. So this is equivalent to having dimension n, just like S2 was equivalent to having dimension 0. Let us prove this one. Suppose X has dimension less than equal to n. With C and P as stated, means closed subset and a point outside, take the neighborhood U which is complement of C. So that is a neighborhood of P. Right, by regularity of X, because X is separable metric space after all, we get an open set V in X such that P is inside V, closure of V is inside complement of C, because P is inside complement of C and complement of C is open. Okay, in between we have got this V and V bar. Since the dimension is less than or equal to n, we get an open set W inside this V P belonging to W in contained inside V, such that now you take D. What is D? D I have to choose, namely boundary of W is of dimension less than equal to n minus 1. Okay, so this is the statement for dimension, I mean condition for dimension being less than equal to n. Okay, now look at x minus d. D is a boundary of something, so it is a closed subset. So x minus d is obviously union of w and x minus w bar. Okay, both of them are open, union is this one, so both of them are closed in x minus d. Okay, p is inside w, all right, and c is inside x minus w bar, because of what? The boundary of w bar doesn't intersect in p. Okay, v bar is contained inside the complement of c, and w is contained inside v, so w bar is also contained inside v bar, so c is contained inside x minus w bar. Okay, conversely, starting with any point in X and an open subset U such that P is inside U, put C equal to complement of C this time. So C is closed subset and P is outside that. From the given condition, we get a closed subset D of dimension less than equal to n minus 1 such that X minus D is separated, A separation B, A bar B, with P is inside A and C is inside B. This implies A is an open subset of X, okay, because D is a closed subset. So A is open inside X minus D and D is closed out, X minus D is open inside X. So A is an open subset of X, P is inside A is contained inside U, okay, because it is disjoint from this C, that's all. Also, boundary of A will be contained inside D and hence of dimension less than equal to n minus 1. So what we have done, starting with any point and an open set, we have produced a neighborhood A such that its boundary is of dimension less than equal to n minus 1. So this is just means that for every point we have done, so we have a base for X consisting of elements A such that their boundaries are less than equal to dimension n minus 1. So that means that dimension of X is less than equal to n. All right. Now, it is convenient and useful to express the condition for a subspace X prime of a space to have dimension less than or equal to n purely in terms of, you know, condition on larger space X. Okay, we know what is the condition of subspace. There is a base for subspace with the whatever blah 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 satisfying. Okay, so we can say that generalized S2 condition, right? So let us convert that purely in terms of X. That will be useful for us. So this lemma says, start with a metric space. This is a general lemma. Okay, let X prime be a subspace. Suppose A and B are subsets of X prime, which are mutually separated in X prime. Remember, mutually separated means A intersection closure of B is empty. Similarly, B intersection closure of A is empty. This time I am taking closures prime inside X prime, because there are two spaces involved here. You don't know where you are taking if you just say closure or B bar and so on. I will use bar to denote the closures inside X, the standard one. Okay, for subspaces I will use this notation, closure prime. Okay. Then there exists open subset W in X such that A is contained inside W, W bar intersection B is empty. So this is again a general result. Okay, while studying metric spaces, we have seen such proofs But let me recall it, because now it's become crucial. Okay, all that I have to do is use the metric property. By the way, this is general thing, just about any metric spaces, okay? So put WA equal to union of all open balls BRA, where A range is inside A, and one condition on R, namely 3 times R, B 3 times RA, ball of radius 3 R around A, does not intersection B. So points of this, you know, A must be far away from B, this one, 3 times B R A must be bigger than, this must be empty. Of course, R should be positive. Alright, this is just the definition. WA is union of all such balls. Similarly, WB is union of BRB is B range over A, same condition, now A and B interchange. B 3RB intersection A is empty. Okay, then clearly both W and WB are open subsets of X because they are unions of open balls. It suffices to show that A is inside WA, WA intersection WB is empty because B is inside WB and that is open. Automatically, it will imply WA bar intersection B is empty. So, after that, you can take W equal to this WA. We want W to be an open set containing A such that its closure in X does not intersect B. Okay, a set does not intersect an open neighborhood around a point, around a set will not intersect, its closure will not intersect that set. Okay, that's all. So let us prove that, okay, A is inside WA and this one inside this one, provided, see, we have not yet stated. So what is the hypothesis? Hypothesis is A and B are separated, mutually separated. We have not used that one yet, right? The basic observation we make here is that if D prime is the metric D restricted to X prime, the same metric but points are taken inside X prime, that is the meaning, okay? Then for all X prime inside X prime, B prime T X prime, this is a definition, T is the radius, X prime is the center. Set of all Y prime in X prime, such that D prime of Y prime X prime is less than T, is nothing but the standard ball in X around X prime and points inside X prime. I am just repeating the meaning of what is the restricted metric here. Let's move over there. Now, A intersection closure of B inside X prime is empty implies, see, these two are A and closure, there exists some point R positive such that the ball of radius 3A, of course this prime I am taking, only everything working inside X prime now, intersection B is empty, okay. But then B3, I am talking about one point here for each A, B3A intersection B is B 3RA intersection X prime B, because see, these things are A and B are inside X after all, X prime after all, okay. This ball is outside, inside X. If you instead B, B is X prime intersection B, I can replace. Once you have X prime, this is nothing B prime of 3RA. B prime 3RA intersection B is empty, okay. So, for each A, if you choose R like this, then what you have got is that point and this neighborhood is inside this. So, this proves that when you take the union, A is contained inside WA. Argument is similar because A and B have been interchanged in defining WB. So, B is also contained inside WB. Alright. Now, you have to prove that WA intersection WB is empty. And that is why we are taking only balls of radius R, but condition is on the ball of now 3 times larger that one, B3R. So that the triangle inequality will help you, that is all here. So standard triangle inequality you have to show. Suppose your point which is in both W A and W B. Okay. That implies this axis inside some BRA as well as in BSB for R and S some positive numbers, right? And A and B are inside A and B respectively. But then distance between A and B, A to X and then X to B will be less than R plus S. Okay, triangle inequality here. B3R A intersection B is empty. This implies R plus S must be bigger than 3R. Right, because the ball of 3RA doesn't intersect this. So R plus S must be bigger than this one. Okay, that is what is the meaning of this one? Consolidate one, S is bigger than 2R. Similarly, B3SB intersection A is empty. That is the choice of this S and R after all. That will imply R plus S is bigger than 3S. Okay, but now S is bigger than 2R. So R is bigger than 2S, right? So S is bigger than 2R, R is bigger than 2S. Oh, that is absurd. And there are different ways of getting contradiction. Once you know that, the triangle inequality has to be used here. Okay, now let us go to the zero dimensional dimension theory. Let X prime contain inside X. Now I am working with a separable matrix basis, okay. Then X prime has dimension less than equal to n if and only if X prime, okay, for every point P belonging to X, there exist arbitrary small neighborhoods W of P in X. I want everything inside X now, okay, such that dimension of this W, boundary of W, is also taken inside X, intersected with X prime is less than or equal to n minus 1. Okay, that is as far as you can go. Everything trying to do only in terms of X, it's not possible. Somewhere you have to involve X prime, and that is involved only at the last moment. You have a neighborhood of that point for every point, okay, inside arbitrary small neighborhood of that point, such that you look at the boundary of that inside X. Now you intersect with X prime, dimension of that must be less than or equal to n minus. Okay, everything, if you don't worry about going to X at all inside X prime, that is true. From that, I have to get a neighborhood W of this point inside X with this property. So that is the gist of the theorem. Okay, and the converse is obvious here anyway. Assume that the given condition is satisfied. So that is part, it's converse part here. Let P belong to X prime and U be a neighborhood of P in X prime. Now every neighborhood can be expanded to a neighborhood of the point inside the larger space, right, by the definition of subspace topology. Let U be a neighborhood of P in X such that U prime is U intersection X prime. Then by the given condition, you have a smaller neighborhood W of P such that W is contained inside U, and dimension of W intersection X prime is of dimension less than or equal to n minus 1. This is the stated condition in the theorem. Now you take U prime equal to W intersection X prime. Then U prime is contained inside V prime, and we know that the boundary of V prime inside X prime is contained inside boundary of W intersection X prime. So this lemma, we are using it again here, which is given to be of dimension less than equal to n minus 1. Okay, so now we can conclude by theorem 9.12 that the dimension of x prime is less than equal to n minus, so n. Okay, now converse, suppose dimension of x prime is less than equal to n. Given a point P inside x prime and a neighborhood open subset in the larger space x such that P is inside U, there exists an open subset V inside x such that P inside V prime, which is V intersection x prime, contained inside U prime, which is U intersection x prime, and dimension of this V prime, boundary of this V prime in x prime has dimension less than to n minus 1. Okay. This is the meaning of dimension of x prime is less than or equal to n. Starting with an arbitrary neighborhood U, inside that I can find a neighborhood V prime with this property because dimension of x prime is less than or equal to n. Okay. The boundary of this x prime is taken inside this one. You recall that this is nothing but closure inside V prime, closure inside x prime of V prime minus V prime, which is same thing as you subtract V, doesn't matter. That is the meaning of this one. All right. Now, recall that if A is an open set in a topological space Y and B is Y minus A bar, then A and B being disjoint open sets, they are mutually separated inside Y. Okay, start with an open subset and take B to be Y minus A bar. So automatically boundary of, you know, A and B are themselves are disjoint open subset, and the union will be so they are separated by boundary of V bar, that's the whole here. Applying this with y equal to x prime, a equal to v prime, and b equal to x prime minus the closure of v prime, closure taken inside x prime. Okay, this general statement I am applying it for y equal to x prime now. Start with the open subset A, which is v prime, and b I am taking the complement of its closure, closure of A here. We conclude that this A and B are mutually separated in x prime. Therefore, by the above lemma, previous lemma, we get an open subset W of x such that V prime is inside W, closure of W intersection x prime minus the closure of this one, that is B, is empty. So, this is B I have taken. Therefore, W bar intersection x prime, if you take only this intersection, that must be contained inside this subset which you have thrown away. Once you throw away this one, it is empty. So, this must be contained inside closure of V prime inside x prime. Okay. We also have V prime is inside contained inside W now. Okay. They started with such a thing, and hence V itself equal to V prime intersection x prime, right? That is how we started with V being a neighborhood of V being an open subset of x here, V prime intersection, that is contained W intersection x prime. So putting these two together, what we have is boundary of W intersection x prime will be boundary of W by definition W bar minus W intersection x prime, which is W bar intersection x prime minus points of W have to be thrown away, W intersection x prime. Okay, but this is nothing but the closure of V, this is contained in the closure of V prime, and that is a large, this is a small subset of this one, this is a larger subset, this is a subset of this one. So this is subset of this one, because this is subset of this one, this is subset of this one. Okay, so but this is nothing but boundary of V prime taken inside x prime, and that is precisely the statement in the converse part. So you took some set theory, set topology here, you see, you have to do it carefully. Now we have a beautiful theorem here, not very beautiful, because you may expect that dimension of the union is equal to dimension of A plus dimension of B. However, such sweeping things won't work, so slight modification is necessary. So yet it is quite beautiful, that is what I want to say. A and B are subsets of a separable metric space, no other condition, then dimension of the union is less than or equal to dimension of A plus dimension of B plus 1. Okay, only thing is they should be defined in the sense that if one of them is infinite, suppose this is infinite, then a dimension of A is infinite, dimension of B, then this is less than or equal to infinite is obvious. If this is infinite, one of them will be infinite. So some such things are there. I want to avoid all that. I want to take the case wherein dimension of A plus B is finite, dimension of A is finite, dimension of B is finite. Okay, you can examine when what happens when they are infinite and so on, no problem. You see, when you are writing inequality here, you have to be careful about something being infinite. And if this is infinity and this is finite, no problem. If this is infinite, this means that one of them here must be infinite. Okay, I am not covering that case here. Okay, let us do induction. Induction can work for finite cases only, right? On the sum dimension of A plus dimension of B, the least value of dimension of A plus dimension of B, both of them empty, is minus 2, right? And then if both of them are empty, it is also empty. Okay, minus 2 plus 1 is minus 1. So this is okay. Okay, you see, even at that level, empty set, okay, dimension of A union B is empty. Is less than or equal to minus 1 won't have made sense, right? See, minus 1 is not less than or equal to minus 1 plus minus 1. So you have to add one more. Even at that level, this plus 1 is necessary there, okay? Even at the very beginning. Alright. So this case is over, the least case. Alright. Now assume dimension of A plus B, dimension of A plus dimension of B is greater than or equal to minus 1, which just means that at least one of A or B must be non-empty, that's all. Okay, suppose the statement is true for all pairs of spaces A prime B prime, whenever this happens, namely for which dimension of A prime plus dimension of B prime is less than dimension of A plus dimension of B. This is the inductive hypothesis here. Not just for A and B. Okay. Whenever, see, this is some number which is bigger than or equal to minus 1. For numbers which are smaller than this, namely sum total, the induction is on this one, right? Smaller than that, the property should be true, namely dimension of A prime union B prime should be less than or equal to 1 plus dimension of A prime plus dimension of B prime. That is the inductive hypothesis. Then we want to prove it for one higher, namely first of all it follows that A union B is non-empty. That is what I have told you already. Take P to be in the union, okay, B and U be a neighborhood of P. By symmetry, we may assume P is either in A or in B. So you assume A just for writing down the proof. By the previous theorem, there exists a neighborhood V of P such that V is contained inside U and dimension of V intersection A is less than equal to dimension of A minus 1. The previous theorem enters here. You see, everything is happening inside X except the last condition, namely dimension of WV, Daba V intersection A is of dimension less than equal to this one. Okay. So we also have dimension of boundary of V intersection B is less than dimension of B by, because subspaces have this dimension. Here is just the subspace. Okay. Therefore, we can apply the induction to the pair boundary of V intersection A and boundary of V intersection B. These by A prime B prime. The sum total dimension is smaller than dimension of A plus dimension of B. One is smaller, strictly A minus 1. The other one is at least that much. So, sum total will be less than dimension of A plus dimension of B. Therefore, induction hypothesis should be applicable to these two subspaces. Okay, to conclude that the union of these two subspaces is less than or equal, dimension less than or equal to 1 plus dimension of the first one is A minus 1, dimension of A minus 1 here, you see, the other one is less than or equal to dimension of B. Okay, so sum total 1 and 1 cancels out, dimension of dimension. Okay. Since this is true for every point P inside union, from the previous theorem, we conclude that dimension of the space, namely A union B, must be 1 plus dimension of A plus dimension of B. See, this is for the boundary of the neighborhood. So, 1 plus will be, one more will be the dimension of the space itself. So, induction is quite easy here. Once you have this theorem which gives you, you know, in terms of the ambient space A union B, instead of I do not have to work with A by A and separate B separately, this boundary of V is taken inside A union B. Now we have another easy corollary, which is something funny here, you can say. Union of n plus 1 subspaces of dimension 0 has dimension less than or equal to n. You can't say it is dimension 0. Okay. Dimension, when you take union, may go up one at a time. You have seen that in the previous. No, we haven't seen that. That is the statement of previous theorem. So, this is an easy corollary to the previous thing, namely, you know, you take A two zero dimensional spaces, the union is less than or equal to dimension 1. One take one more, less than or equal to 1 plus 1 and so on, it goes on, right. So, you will get dimension less than or equal to n. Now, here is an example now. Start with any integer n, possibly positive, otherwise there won't be anything left here, and take m to be smaller than that. Okay, you can take equality also. Let m upper n lower m, curly m upper m lower n, denote the space of all points in Rn. At most m of whose coordinates are rational. Here we had curly Rmn earlier, wherein exactly m coordinates were rational and so on. Now, at most, so you have to be very careful here, okay. At most, m of whose coordinates are rational and curly Lnm, same nm, denote the space of all points of in Rn, at least m of whose coordinates are rational. Okay, n is the total dimension Rn. This m denotes how many coordinates are rational and how many coordinates are irrational here. The first part is for m, at most m of them are rational. The second part is at most, at least m of them are rational. Okay, then dimension of curly m is less than or equal to m. Dimension of curly L less than or equal to N minus M. Okay. How do you do that? Let us look at this space. Coordinates at most M of them are rational. So you can start with R N 0, which is no coordinate is rational. okay, it is full, all the coordinates are irrational. This R and 0, we know that is 0 dimensional. Then R n 1, exactly one coordinate is, you know, at most m coordinates are rational, right? Exactly one coordinate is rational, that is also included here, like that 1, 2, 3 up to m. Okay, exactly, now each of them we know, we have studied, they are 0 dimensional. How many are there? M plus 1, right? So dimension is less than about m. Exactly similarly, we have the other way around here. Here at least m times m of the coordinates are rational. So take all the m are rational, okay? At least m of whose coordinates are rational, R n m, then R n m plus 1, okay, one more, how many? All of them, R n m, they are all, again we have studied, they are all 0 dimensional. How many are there? N minus m plus 1, right? Therefore, the total dimension is less than n minus. We will stop here. We will continue again next time, some theorems for n-dimensional spaces. Thank you.